Throughout all my times of reading Bleach, I always have to go back and read some material that to just go and refresh my mind, and I always turn out that I always learn something new or get a new perspective of in general. And it hasn't been until quite recently that people have been able to enjoy Bleach's story writing. Maybe that's because of the increase of social media and people have been able to discuss it more, but back in the day, it was a little bit of a good meme. You know, Bleach wasn't written well, there was ass pulls, you know, people didn't understand things, and people just written off as poor writing, when in actual fact, we come to know, if you've watched a lot of my videos, that there is a lot of foreshadowings, and there's a lot of reference, and there's a lot of actual building up that goes into Bleach's writing. And we're going to get more into that, because I come across an article that was retweeted by Piroshi, who is a CC2 CEO, retweeting this out of his shock and amusement over the fact that this title, saying that 0.01% of readers of Bleach will actually see a lot of foreshadowing within the story. And to be honest, without reading this Japanese article, I absolutely completely agreed. Because there is a lot of stuff in Bleach that people just don't get on their first read and don't connect the dots. Because a lot of series out there like to handhold you like a child and tell you what's going on or what someone can do and how something is. While Kubo does it differently. He shows it through maybe one line or maybe shows it through a facial expression. One of these, of course, being Hollow Ichigo while he's fighting Ichigo and he's telling him his Zangetsu. Maybe this was a bit earlier on. I'm just going from the top of my head. You can see within the reflection of Zangetsu, even though Hollow Ichigo's face is smiley, in the reflection of the sword, is actually pretty sad. And it's those kind of characteristics that you need to really pay close attention to, because these are subtle foreshadowings of what was to come very much later on in the series. And to show that Zangetsu, you know, was actually Zangetsu and wasn't actually, you know, the bad Hollow that Ichigo thought he was going to be. So, again, let's read this article. I found it was really interesting, and maybe you guys can learn something along the way as well. Some of them have a discovery rate of 0.01%, question mark? The hint of Mr. Taikubo is so great that even if you read it many times, you will still find new discoveries. To which I actually have to agree, because as I said, after doing this for many years, there's still things that I find out. More recently, the Ichibei covering Yuabok's name or Zangetsu's name very early on in the series, and I don't think anyone would have known that. I'd never saw an article, I never saw a Reddit post, I never saw a Twitter post, I never saw anything of anyone ever mentioning this until Kubo announced it in his Q&A. Well, I guess the person writing the Q&A knew, because obviously he wrote the question, but Kubo confirmed it. But regardless of what, that was mind-boggling, because again, I hadn't seen that in all the years that I've been reading this series. That's over 10 years. Or more, even so. So, you know, pretty big deal. As Mr. Kubo himself said in a postscript of the novel version Can't Fear Your Own World 2, foreshadowing leveling is set, and some of them should be noticed by 1 in 10,000 people. There is. That's why the hint of Bleach is amazing, so let's talk about that. It's fun not only to read, but also to add predictions and uncover undisclosed settings, so-called consideration, but especially the fact that the structure of the story itself is a hint of future development. There are many combinations in which the structure of the battle with the boss character of the Espada in the middle of the story is the hint of the final chapter's Thousand Year Blood War battle with Byakuya versus Zomari. It is interesting that Zomari and Asnote have in common and have the design of eyes, and that Zomari's standing position changes because it's connected in battle with Asnot. Let's talk about two things like the above. Now, personally, I would have said this is a bit of a reach, but given these examples that are going to come up, it seems like this is a reoccurring theme of what was to come to be, such as, for example, what we're about to read here, Shunsui Kyoroku versus Coyote Stark. Shunsui Kyoroku, the captain of the 8th Division, becomes the general captain in the Thousand Year Blood War. The fact that he fought against Stark, who is the number one Espada, and became a hint to Kyoroku later on to become general captain, and it seems now. The eye patch was also something that they had in common, and there's one more thing to worry about. Kyoroku's Zanpakuto was a rare Zanpakuto considering of two swords, but originally one power was divided into two powers, which led the relationship between Stark and Lilinet. It is interesting that Liliboro, the Quincy who Kyoroku will fight in the Thousand Year Blood War, is also the same gunner as Stark. Again, a lot of parallels with who Kyoroku fights. He fights the number one Espada. They both have dual weapons. The eye patch comes later on, such as like Coyote Stark. And again, with Liliboro having a gun as well. So again, it's a theme that fits. And whether you want to classify it as foreshadowing to later events is completely up to the reader. But again, I do see a connection, because again, again, this connection follows through. Kenpachi Zaraki versus Noritora. While Noritora's arms are increasing, Kenpachi, who wins by budding his arms in one, is the best battle that seems to have the most decided contrast in the battle. If I had read it firmly at the time, keeping in mind that Neliel was behind Noritora, I wondered if a female character named Yatri would soon appear in front of Kenpachi. When I think about it, I have a little regret in the fact that Kenpachi will engage in a deadly battle with Unohana Yatsuru in the Thousand Year Blood War. The contrast between Nell, who has become a small figure, can also be used as an example with Yatsuru as well. Now, of course, if you don't know with Kenpachi, it's not really kind of been made public as of much, is that Yatsuru is just a small portion of an actual older Yatsuru who is within Kenpachi. And just like with Noritora, Neliel is a small child that was once a grown woman. And the contrast here is that both characters are striving towards something that isn't related to either a woman or a small woman, I guess you could say. I know that sounds very weird, but trust me, it makes sense. Kenpachi is kind of fighting for Yatsuru, and Yatsuru is the only one he kind of fights for, in a sense, and gets strength for to protect her and kind of has a bond with her. While Noritora kind of gets strength in contrast to trying to beat Neliel and kick her while she's down and obviously get rid of her adult form and keep her in a childlike state, because obviously he couldn't bear the fact that a woman was stronger than him. So obviously he beat the shit out of her, misogyny. But again, these are two parallels of which, even in the Arrancar arc or even in the Espada arc, whatever you want to classify it as, is that these parallels were for foreshadowings later on, especially within the characters, especially within the heat of battle. There's obviously some more little foreshadowings that are more known now, such as like when Masaki died and Isshin could get his powers back, because obviously he was keeping Masaki alive through his, stopping his spiritual pressure from merging in with Hollow spiritual pressure and killing it, etc, etc. So there's subtleties. Actually, a more recent one as well, which in the latest chapter of Bleach, the very, very latest one, whether you want to classify it as the last chapter or not, it's completely up to you, talks about the concept of Rei and how Soul Reapers have a certain grade and level, and apparently, like, three and above can't actually, go back to reincarnation. They have to go straight to hell because how powerful their spiritual pressure is. This was actually hinted very early on in the series when it came to Kayan as well, talking about, like, how he was, like, a grade 6 or 5. Again, I'm going off the top of my head, but of course there will be a screenshot on screen. So it's not trying to go above and beyond and saying, Kubo is, like, a masterclass, right? But I generally do believe it when he says he has implemented foreshadowings that no one has really even gotten to this point. And how long is the series? 20 years? The series has been done for about 6-7 years, something, give or take, So it is very surprising how still to this day we find new stuff about Bleach that we didn't in our first, second, 20th run, 50th run, me. But it's kind of interesting, and I did have a comment talking about, would you rather a series kind of diminish itself like that? You can have a basic series that tells you its story, hand feeds you everything that you wanted to know very quickly, and that series doesn't have longevity. I mean, it can if it's really, really good and it's really enticing and it has like a good adaptation and, etc, etc. Of course, those series exist. But to have a series which people called bad for like the longest time, but then people gradually start to appreciate the writing as it goes on, makes it a discussion piece. And I probably would prefer that, because there's still a lot of discussion and it keeps the series, again, relevant throughout all those years and brings new fans and it brings a stronger fan base because of that. And I would rather a series get praised for being underappreciated than to be appreciated and then die later on in the future very quickly, if that makes sense. Either way, I wanted to do a video on this because I thought it was really interesting and really fascinating, and hopefully you guys could learn something as well. Sure, we looked at the parallels between fights, Kyoraku and Stark, Kenpachi, Noritora, even Byaki and Asnot. But there's also things as well, such as like White's reflection in his sword. But there's also the connection with Kayan and Rei and how that grading system was implemented very early on in the series, but we didn't know about. Hell, even the Hell Butterflies, very chapter one, they were called Hell Butterflies, and we kind of knocked it off on the head because Hell Butterflies, they were just there. Like, we didn't really pay attention to them because we just thought that they were just there and they existed. But to have these little small things get presented to us makes us go back on the stories and actually see what the Hell Butterflies were doing. And when you do that, you kind of think, I wasn't paying attention. Or maybe you was. But at the end of the day, it always gives you a fresh look into a series you thought you had read and watched 1,000 times. And that is special. And that is at its most, the highest amount of praise. Now, if we could get a massive adaptation from start to finish showcasing these things, that'd be amazing. But, you know, we're just going to have to settle with the Thousand Year Blood War arc for now. Either or, tell me your guys' thoughts in the comment section down below of what you think of this level of foreshadowing. Is it the best level of foreshadowing in Shonen Jump? I don't know. People argue it's One Piece. Again, we won't know until One Piece is over. But I think Bleach is pretty up there in terms of story writing. And we have to come to this consensus now that whether we like it or not, or whether you didn't like Bleach in the past, you have to start admitting that this is a very well-written story. With that being said, I'm going to catch you guys. That you guys, of course, have this fight. I've been Hansen. And as always, people, peace out.